On air? Perfect. So it's a tall order. Lights here rahengi? Lights aise hi rahengi na? Aap dekh lo. You guys will get a chance to see the slides, I guess, a little better. So it's a tall order whenever a guy from IIM Calcutta is given an opportunity to speak to folks from IIM Ahmedabad and be given a guarantee that he'll be listened to, which has never happened with my friends in the past from IIM Ahmedabad. So I thought I'd take this opportunity to actually take a leaf out of your books and put a presentation together and discuss that with you. My mandate is for the next 1 hour, actually 45 minutes, so till about 6, I'll walk you through the PepperFry journey, how we started, some of the pitfalls we faced, what you guys potentially, as you embark on startups, should not do, and potentially you should be open to doing. And then I'll leave the last half an hour open for any questions that you guys might have. Does that work? Yeah? So, till about 6. So, my name is Ambareesh. I come from, so my surname is not Gupta, Agarwal, Bahal, or anything else. My surname is Vedantam, which is like a very powerful South Indian surname for a poor Brahminical boy. And therefore, I have no business in my blood. And PepperFry was the first time that anybody in countless generations of my family decided to start something, especially start a business. So a lot of what I learned was stuff that I learned, so to speak, on the job. I've had the opportunity to work with some great companies in the past. I am an FMCG guy to start with, then had a stint in financial services, used to be the CEO of eBay, back in the days when eBay was a force to reckon with in India, and then decided to start PepperFry.com in 2012. So that's my background in a nutshell. I'm an engineer, like he said, IIM Calcutta. And yes, went to IIM Calcutta because at that point in time, IIM Calcutta had something called the open system, which involved no attendance whatsoever. And I took full advantage of it. So so that's me in a nutshell. Here's how Ashish, my co-founder, and I, when we were starting PepperFry, this is what we thought of. This is what we set for ourselves as, so to speak, our mantra. And we said we would look to build India's home store. Now, very broad, fairly basic, but what we meant by this was, if anybody wants anything for their homes, please, for their homes, they should be able to find it on PepperFry. Now, along with this, we put three words on the, so to speak, whiteboard, or, you know, the blackboard when we started. The first word was, be Indian. The second one was, be honest. And the third phrase was, have fun. So, Indian, honest, and fun is the basis on which we set up our company. And even our name, PepperFry, for example, translates from these three objectives that we laid down that we would follow for the organization. So pepper is something that India has been famous for ages. It's the reason, so to speak, that the West discovered us. You know, all those trade routes and the monsoon winds, etc., were followed fundamentally for pepper. And pepper is also a very honest spice. Everybody knows the smell, taste, etc., of pepper. However, it's because it's so honest and everybody knows everything about it, it also tends to become a little boring, right? And the fun of pepper happens when you do that tadka, and therefore pepper fry. So we set ourselves the goal of being Indian, being honest, and having fun as we set up this company and ran it. And our journey, here's Ashish. So one of the things I forgot to tell you about, and I'm an avid trekker. I love trekking. It doesn't show. However, trust you me, I enjoy trekking. And one of the things I learned was while I was trekking and I was thinking things through, I realized that there are lots of similarities between going on a trek, going on a particular course, and then figuring out how you're going to do your startup journey. So I used the motifs, all the background visuals are that of treks. So if you're wondering as to why are people in random clothing, it's because this is like a trekking deck. So that's me. I call myself Uncle at PepperFry. There are two things I do. I increase the average age at PepperFry and I reduce the average IQ. And I set up PepperFry with my bestie, who's Ashish. I mean, if you think Lady Gaga is stylish, you should meet Ashish. He is a fantastic style diva, so to speak, and he lives the 40-20 rule. And frankly, the first thing you need to do before you start up, or even think of doing a startup is, have you got a great friend to do it with? And I think that's where we were really fortunate as PepperFry, that Ashish and I are such great friends. Because you know what? There will be ups, there will be tons of downs, especially on a startup journey. And if you have somebody who is truly a friend, somebody who you can have the fight with, say whatever you want to, have him say whatever he or she wants to say to you, and still come out of it knowing that you guys are great friends, I think half your problems as an entrepreneur are sorted from that day. And I was really lucky that Ashish agreed to, you know, go on this PepperFry journey with me. So my bestie, Ashish. And like every journey, I guess ours also started with a really small step. And these are things that I think matter a lot as you look to start up. And the first thing that matters is figure out who is it that you wish to work with. Look, money comes, capital will chase good ideas, capital will chase companies which are doing well, capital will even chase startups. What you have to be very clear about is how are you going to approach the entire journey? Who are the people that you're going to want to work with? So what we decided to do was that we would work with the smartest, most passionate, and hungriest people that we had ever met, right? And every single hiring decision, especially at all leadership levels, right up to mid-management at PepperFry, these three words, smarts, hunger, and passion, have been defining characteristics of everybody who's you know, decided to work with PepperFry, joined PepperFry, or been hired into PepperFry. And this is very important. Your choices could be different from these, but take the time to put it down on, so to speak, a blackboard. You getting me? It will help you. Remember that some of these choices about what you are, what you stand for, what the company stands for, what is it that you're looking to build, aren't choices you will be able to undo in 5 years' time, especially if you do well. Choices will be easier to undo if you don't do well, because then everybody, their uncle, and the entire ecosystem will be telling you all the mistakes you've made. It's when you're doing well that nobody's going to be telling you all the mistakes you're making, right? And at that point in time, undoing these choices is going to be the toughest thing that you will ever get to do. So take the time, put down what is the first thing you want to start with. And the first thing we decided to start with was work with the hungriest, most passionate, and the smartest people that we had ever worked with or we knew. And consequently, I actually got some really great guys. This is my CMO. He's a guru. My CFO doesn't agree with me on anything. And frankly, that's a great thing to have. That's a great quality to have in a CFO. If a CFO agrees always with a CEO, there's something wrong in the organization, right? So my CFO disagrees with me on everything, but he's, I think, amongst India's coolest CFOs. My CTO, God calls him God. I mean, I do not have a technology background. That's the other thing. When you're looking to hire and you're looking to set up your team, you should be clear about what you can and cannot do. What are you good at? After having worked for about 10 odd years, and I was one of those guys who started up in my mid-30s, right? So I had the advantage of going through a period of time in corporate life where a lot of people made me realize what I was not very good at. And I realized I was not very good at in technology. And therefore, technology is not my forte. And therefore, I needed to have somebody on the technology team that I could trust completely and implicitly. And Sanjay is that guy, right? And then you have to have, for all of these four passionate, smart, high-energy guys, you need to have somebody who smiles on a regular basis. The photo doesn't show him smiling, but trust me, he's like the cutest guy ever. And he runs the furniture business at PepperFry. So he's a super hard taskmaster. He gets it done. He's got the numbers orientation that any great business requires. And he's got a smile on his face. And just that smile on his face makes you want to come into office on a regular basis, right? So you have to, so once you choose the smartest, most passionate guys, you got, and you get lucky, and I am certain I got lucky. Every single day I get humbled by the fact that folks like these even chose to work with PepperFry. And I think we got lucky, but once you, when you, you get lucky, hire them fast, right? The other thing, the second aspect of So one is how you start up. Put down what is it, what are the kind of people you want to work with. So first thing is get a great co-founder. Second thing is who are the kind of people you'd want to work with. And the kind of people you'd want to work with would be could go beyond employees. Could even be a statement of who are the kind of clients you wish to service. Who are the kind of consumers you wish to service. Be clear, right? We picked employees, we put that down. But you could pick clients, you could pick consumers. That's fine. The third thing is start small. Always think small. Make your decisions based on a very minute detail of efficiency, etc., etc. However, dream big. You getting me? There's a distinction. Very often, the most profligate spending across any startup happens. Any guesses as to when it happens? Any guesses from anybody? When do startups spend money the most? Sorry? Initial phase. Any other guesses? Sorry? While growing. Any other guesses? Right after they've raised like a fantastic round. So if you've gone and raised, let's say, an initial stage, $10 million, and you were superbly bootstrapped right till you raised $10 million, the moment you have $10 million in your bank, you will start thinking about hiring more people, building a better product, getting your tech infrastructures upgraded right up to, I don't know, rocket science or NASA levels and so on. That's the time then most of the money gets spent. What you have to ensure as you start up, as you go on this journey is, that's the time when you have to be absolutely careful. Getting me? There is this, I think it's Kabir, and he said, there was this doha, which my mother used to tell me, and remember my mother was a scientist, no business background, but she used to say this, and she was a junior scientist at IARI. Dukh mein sumiran sab kare, sukh mein kare na koye. Jo sukh mein sumiran kare, usse dukh kahe ko hoye. And if you apply that to startup economics, here's how it works. When you have money in the bank, is when you have to be most careful about how you're spending it. If you are careful about how you're spending it, then you will not worry about when you will never come to a situation when you will not have money in the bank. Got it? Right? So every time, think small, think minute details, think a detail orientation. However, have big ambitions. And when you think that there's an opportunity, somebody called out growth. And here's, you know, there's growth on the table and you can get it, move fast. In India, many a times you hear, I want to be the next something or the other, I want to be the next something or the other, I want to be the next something. You know what that indicates in India as a country overall? It means that there's a higher premium to execution in India than to the idea. And therefore, for you, it's really important to get the execution right. And one of the elements of getting the execution right is moving fast, executing fast, getting stuff done faster than anybody else can, getting them done more perfectly than anybody else can. And that is what translates into being would be a great indicator that perhaps you're here to win the Indian startup, whatever. And incidentally, I haven't put numbers. However, that's roughly the ratio at which we grew the first year we operated, the third year we operated, and the fifth year we operated, right? So you can see, I think it translates into 3.5x or something like that. Some really nice number. And we've made mistakes. And you will make mistakes. And very often, the mistakes will happen because you miss out on the details. India's got 1 billion people. 1 billion people will consume my service, and you know, therefore I will build a $1 trillion company. Yep, but out of those 1 billion people, how many are today ready to consume a service? How many of them are part of your addressable market today? All of those things are specific details you need to get to at the strategy level. And then eventually, when you're executing, deciding whether you want to hire 2,000 people only to have to fire 1,800 of them 6 months later, that's not a good thing. Be careful about how many you wish to have. So God is in the details. It's very often when we miss the details, and we've had our fair share of misses, right? Is when you make those mistakes, is you get bitten. right? So the idea of the slide is there's this spider, which one of the tour operators told us was like super poisonous, and we were just brushing past the rock, not worrying about it. So anyways, so only to be bitten later if you miss out on the details. So try and focus on the details. Details are everything that you'd want to go with, especially as you're building a company and starting afresh. The other thing, and be conscious, look, a startup journey, and including PepperFry's, and which is why I've written the word pivot, and I'll explain that, is not always an up-and-up journey. Sometimes you got to come down to, you know, catch your breath, so to speak, and prepare to go up again. Let me give you an example out of our book. When we started in 2012, January, and PepperFry is about five and a half years old, when we started, we thought we'd want to sell all kinds of lifestyle products. So we used to even sell some fashion products, etc. But we used to sell them using a marketplace model, which really didn't work in the fashion category, which was fundamentally all driven by inventory, etc., etc. So about, let's say, about 10 months into starting up as an overall lifestyle side, we said, what are the mistakes we're making? And we realized that we were trying to adapt a business model onto a product category which didn't have a proper model category fit, so to speak. And therefore, we pivoted out of everything that we were doing which was not home-related. And that, incidentally, was 35% of our business. So while we decided not to do it, it still was 35% of our business. So on the 1st of April 2012, or 2013, which is exactly about 14 months from when we started as an overall lifestyle, we pivoted to becoming a pure home and furniture player, right? And that's, to me, an example of, we gave up 35% of the business to make us into a better organization, to have a business model which works extensively across all the categories that we choose to play in. So therefore, not all every startup journey is only about the up and up. You hear about people doing down rounds, etc. That's fine. At the end of the day, here's how it works. Has anybody been on it? Do folks go on treks? Just a quick show of hands. Awesome. I only started 3 years back, which is why I'm A, so passionate about it. I'm a reformed trekker. And B, I hope I'd started earlier. So you'd realize that very often there's a starting point and you say, okay, you will climb 1,000 meters. The guidebooks will say that you'll climb 1,000 meters today. But in doing so, you would come down 300 meters at least 5-6 times, go up 500 meters again 5-6 times, and then come down and then go up again to reach that final spot. So what you would effectively have done, to get to a delta of 1,000 meters, you would have effectively climbed something like 3,000-4,000 meters perhaps in a day. Right? And that's exactly what happens in a startup. The end goal is what you need to be clear about. You will have to occasionally come down. Occasionally, you'll have to do radical stuff like pivot your business. And it's all part of the journey. Don't get psyched by it. I mean, it's easy for me to say it now. I pivoted 3 years back. But frankly, I mean, if you have the right partners, you won't get psyched by it. So a startup journey is not always about the up and up. It is very often also about coming down to make a difference. Yep. It's also important to wait for people to catch up. Look, if you do well and your team expands, so in the first 10, 15, perhaps even 100 people that you'll have on board, you will know everybody. Anything that you as potentially CEOs of startup firms say will be known one-on-one by everybody that you work with. However, as you get to 200 people, as you get to 300 people, as you get to 400 people, sometimes there will be communication distortion. A great strategy thought of in a boardroom, when it finally will come down to execution on the ground, might vary significantly. And that will be because of communication distortions. What you got to do is you got to take the time to communicate as widely as you possibly can, as many times as you might need to ensure that all execution that happens as per what you originally conceived as your plan would be. Got it? So therefore, it's sometimes important for you to wait for people to catch up. Because, like I explained, only with alignment, which is through communication, will you get success. Finally, you know, you start up, you sometimes are not able to raise funds in the initial phases. Sometimes you think that the product that you've built is not getting as much traction because consumers are just not, you know, ready for it. Sometimes you think that the complexities and logistics are such that, they're unsurmountable. All of those things and questions will come to you as entrepreneurs. It could be in any field. It could be in e-commerce, could be in furniture, could be in content, could be in media, could be in starting a new shop, right? Sometimes they seem unsurmountable. But the thing is, they aren't necessarily unsurmountable. The thing is, you got to learn what's going wrong. Yeah, you got to change what you can, but you can only change if you acknowledge that there's a problem. Very often, as an entrepreneur, I guess what I'm trying to say is, entrepreneurship or being an entrepreneur or the CEO of a company, especially of a startup which you're doing, is a responsibility. It does not allow you to have megalomania. And if you don't have megalomania, you will actually see what the problems are. You will try and solve them because you're responsible for the choices that the other people who are working with you have made, which have made them join you and work with you as a company. Got it? See, it's more about the responsibilities you have, the duties that you have towards the people that you work with. Could be business partners, could be employees, could be investors, could be financial partners. It's more about the responsibilities. It's less about your rights. So therefore, never lose sight of being able to evaluate a problem dispassionately, if I might use that term. Because only if you identify that there's a problem, you know what the problem is, will you even be able to solve it. And very often, I think there are very smart people in this room, you will be able to solve it. Yep. Yeah. And when you come to what is it that you need to solve, you'll have to change strategy. And let me give you examples of what we did in PepperFry. We realized that as we were growing, one of the things that we relied on was our knowledge of the people that we worked with, right? Because, look, we were 20 people in Jan of 2012. We are today, including all supply chain staff, close to 1,400. And that's a fairly rapid pace of growth. And there was a time about a couple of years back, we realized that our classical method of managing people, which is knowing everybody, knowing what the, you know, how they work, et cetera, doesn't work because the organization's now become really big. So we actually went ahead and invested in a performance management setup, a process, and actually an entire system, which enabled us to manage the ladder. This is everybody else. So it feels good. And if you are looking to get into the furniture space or in a space related to home, here's a construct you can think of. It's something that we think of as we look to build our organization, the choices we make. And the construct is catchment, consumers, community, content, and capabilities. And here's how we do it. Catchment is how many ways can a customer interact with you, be it in the offline world, be it online, off a laptop or a computer, or be it on mobile, or be it through virtual reality, be it whatever way. What's the way of interaction of a customer with you? And how do you keep expanding it? So if today you're building a business which involves, let's say, a customer interacting with you on a mobile app, think about that customer also from time to time might be using a PC. So therefore, should your existence only be on the mobile app, or should you go beyond it? Does that customer also interact or want to have an interaction with you over the phone? Perhaps you should provide call-in services. I don't know. So think about all the ways that the customer interacts with you and prepare for putting in place the infrastructure such that that interaction is possible. That's what catchment is. Continuously look to serve new customer segments. You will always... So there are two ways businesses grow. The same customers buy more stuff, or new customers buy stuff, right? So it's called depth, which is same customers buy more stuff, or width, more customers buy the same amount of stuff. You will get depth if you're providing the right experience in the two. till they become proper householders, be willing to invest in furniture. And we want to address our products and services to a younger customer segment, the millennial segment. And so therefore, we continuously look at serving new customer segments. The third area is community. And as you look to define what community is, we think of it very simply. We think of a community as being anybody who is able to influence the course of direction of your business. So let me give you an example. For us, a community involves every architect, every interior designer who works with PepperFry. It involves every architect, every interior designer who today does not work with PepperFry, but potentially has an has a chance to become a PepperFry channel partner going forward. It could be a community of developers who are developing new stuff which we can use as part of the PepperFry platform. So think about how you're going to grow the community you have around your business. How do you interact with the community you have around the business? And here, just think of it broadly enough. Anybody who can influence the outcome of your business or influence the direction of your business is part of your community. If you're in the furniture business and you are not focused on how logistics as an industry is going, perhaps you're making a mistake. Because it's important, because logistics and the entire logistics and shipping community is actually part of your community or your ecosystem. So think about your ecosystem, think about the community and how they influence the way. It's very important as you make choices. It'll give you a very good perspective on what are the things you should or should not be doing in your business. Create content, be it anything. Be it a listing on an e-commerce site, could be a song, could be video. The important thing is it needs to engage customers. And that's the only true test of great content. It's not whether you as an entrepreneur have decided that this looks good. It is whether customers have decided that, hey, I want to see this again and again. Getting me? And so whatever you do as a business, and content can go across many forms. You might want to set up a business which helps people get recruited into companies better. The person's CV then becomes the content. And if you're going to help them get recruited better, ensure that they write CVs or help them write CVs which engage potential recruiters way more than other CVs do. So it's your job as you run a business to think about the way you're looking at content and interacting with content and how you're defining content in the ecosystem or the products that you work with. And finally, build capabilities. And this starts with, I guess, us, right? We learn new things. Because we learn new things, our perspective opens. We learn how new technologies can apply to our business in ways we hadn't fathomed would apply, let's say, 2 years back. We learn more about geographies where our businesses could get into. And I don't mean necessarily outside of India. You could start with a hyperlocal business, starting with Ahmedabad, but you then need to build a knowledge about other cities in India and how a business could get replicated in other parts of India. The same business could get replicated, because that's what's going to give you scale. So build knowledge, learn new things on an ongoing basis, and while you're doing it, especially if you're getting to now become a larger organization, forget larger organization, even if you have 10 people in the company, start defining your culture and start sharpening it with everybody who comes into your organization. Because these are things that are going to help. So building capabilities. So these are 5 things that we think about as we build our business. Catchment, the ways consumers interact with you and how you keep expanding that catchment. How are you keeping expanding consumer segments? How do you look at that? How do you gauge how your community works? And that's basically everybody who influences the direction of your business. How you should look at content, how you keep increasing and creating content which engages with customers, and how are you looking to build capabilities on an ongoing basis. So these are the 5 things we think about. And when you do that, and you're still a leader, always remember one thing. There's nothing in business which means that, I am now the leader of the market and I'm done. Because frankly, as a leader, you will have to keep setting new standards on an ongoing basis. So if you today have 60% market share, somebody could come and take that away from you. So you got to be really careful and keep on thinking of new things to do that gets you from, that either keeps you at 60 or gets you from 60 to 70 to 80 or whatever you want to get to. But it's always about the new challenge. Whenever you accomplish one challenge, that's done. Now what is ahead? This is, entrepreneurship is not a journey where, you know, I've now done my bit, I can now chill. That does not happen. That's not how entrepreneurship is. It is about seeking out the next challenge and going after the next challenge on an ongoing basis. I was asked this question outside. I think sometimes you should aspire for higher standards. And one of the highest standards that we've set for ourselves is, will we become India's first profitable e-commerce company? I guess the chances are high. Hopefully in the next 12 to 15 months, we will know. But these are higher standards. I mean, growth's not enough. It has to be a balance between growth and profitability. And, while there are times markets will say, okay, growth is everything that, you know, you should go after. As a businessman, always think about, is your business sustainable? Is it equity capital, which is balance sheet capital, which is driving growth? Or is it actually P&L that is driving, or investments remade from the P&L that's driving growth? That's an important call that you as a businessman need to be very conscious of at all points in time. You can make either call. Both calls have... Thank you. And I've ended 9 minutes earlier than I thought I would. Yeah. So you have about 30 minutes. Any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Hello, sir. My name is Arun. Since you started your company around after 10 years of work experience and all the stuff, you should be probably having financial commitments when you started the venture. I'm not sure if you raised the funds in the initial stages or you you ran the company to a level before going for equity funding or VC funding. Yeah. So how did you sustain over that period?
So, and you don't mind if I ramble a little as I answer this question, right? So I come from a middle-class background. My father passed away when I was 7 years old. My mother was the only working member in the family, and she had a job of, she was a research scientist with the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, IARI, in Delhi. The first house that was bought in my entire family, including my mom and aunts, was by me when I was 33 years old. Never had a house till then. So one of the things that I think, and I think I always wanted to do something on my own, somehow. One of the things that kept me back was needing to be in a position where I have some degree of financial security if things don't go off well, right? And it took me about 10 to 12 years to get there. And the moment I got there, I decided now is the time for me to do something. So that's how I thought about it. I, however, also decided when I started off that if I had a large car, I sold it off, got a smaller car. And I did all this. If I was living in a particular house and if it was on rent, I moved to a smaller house because I wanted to reduce any financial liabilities that I might further have. Because think about where I was coming from, right? I had a single working mom who was by that time retired. And actually, when I started off, she had passed away a year back. So, but who had always, you know, who was retired and she was fairly old and we are old kids. And I had no financial fallback. And therefore, I decided to get some degree of financial stability for myself and my family going before I started up, which is why it took me 10 to 12 years. After I did start up, I, of course, took all my savings and I put it into PepperFry to start with. And one of the things that, so Ashish and I had saved a bit of money while we were working. And we started, getting people on board and building our product out in August, September of 2011. Which is why we launched in 2012 January, right? And at that point in time, we didn't have any financial, we didn't have any funding. So we were putting in our own money. And there was a time in early September where I think we were down to, after having worked so many years, down to our last 10 lakh rupees in the bank, okay? And we said, what do we do with this money? And there were, right, at that time, 30 people who used to work with PepperFry. So we said, if we're going to fail, and we were very close to failure, just 10 lakh rupees in the bank, and a product not yet launched, we said, okay, let's fail spectacularly. So we took all 30 folks and we went to Goa for the first PepperFry offsite, where for 2 days, all of the 30 folks, A, got to know each other, We made presentations on what their roles would be, defined for themselves, what their roles would be at PepperFry, what they were bringing to the table, as well as we worked on the fundamental business plan and any changes that we'd want to make in it, to it as we launch in January. I think the best 10 lakh rupees I ever spent in my life. We came back from there, and about 2 weeks from then, Norwest Ventures funded us with $5 million. So, yeah, I mean, you know, there are these moments. I guess the PepperFry. So I guess it's a mixed bag. I think both kinds work. I mean, if you have the ability to start up earlier, start up earlier. If you don't have the ability to start up earlier, keep the dream alive and start up when you have the ability to. That's what I do.
Hi, sir.
Hi.
I wanted to ask, I've been to the Bangalore 100 feet road. There's a PepperFry studio. I mean, the furnitures were very elegant and really classy.
Thank you.
They were, to me, they seemed to be, I won't say expensive, probably they are actually worth it. So we went back and again went online and bought the furnitures online, and they were cheaper. So what is the purpose of these studios? Is it for visibility, or is it the class that you want to define? Because ultimately, most of us buy online itself. So we couldn't like think of buying from there.
So you know that we don't sell from the studios any which way, right? None of the studio products. So we don't sell from any of the PepperFry studios.
Okay.
And let me tell you why we don't do it and why we set up the PepperFry studios. So we set them up, yes, to build trust amongst consumers, because it's an early stage market in India. And especially furniture is a high involvement product. Most of you folks are management students or fundamentals of management. So there's this thesis, right? It exists. So consumer behavior operates on, let's say, fundamentally three parts. There's routine response behavior, there's limited problem solving, and then there's extensive problem solving. So on a continuum, the lowest amount of information slash involvement is routine response behavior. That's like buying toothpaste and soap. And extensive problem solving is buying a house, right? We operate somewhere in the middle. And in this middle zone, which is limited problem solving, consumers need to need a lot of assurances, and trust becomes a very important part of the overall let's say utility function, which enables a person to buy. And PepperFry studios help build trust. How they build trust is because even if you're not going to buy the product that's in the studio, you know what the quality of the product is. And that's how PepperFry studios were conceived. And we actually set up our first studio in December of 2014. That was a time when, frankly, Omni channel, as is today's buzzword, wasn't even sexy back then, right? I mean, it was, I think when we set up our first store, we just did it because we thought it was important for our business to do it. So set up for visibility, for building trust. Your second part of your question was, sorry.
So we ended up buying online.
The second part of the question was, you ended up buying online. And you know why we don't sell from the store? We do not sell from the stores because there are two fundamental value propositions in PepperFry. One is that we will give you great value. So frankly, you will, like you thought the product would be expensive, but it will not be. And the reason why it's not is we are interacting direct with the manufacturers in places like Jodhpur. We're cutting out the middlemen, and we're passing on the benefits to consumers, right? That's our business model. So we'll give you great value. The second thing is we'll give you great variety. If you wish to look for a bed, right, you don't need to stop at 3 beds, 5 beds, 10 beds, or even 50 beds. We'll show you 250 of them, or perhaps 500, right? Or if you're looking for a sofa, we'll show you 500 sofas. So variety is our core proposition. Now, a PepperFry studio is about 2,500 square feet, right? Not very large. How many sofas can I show there maximally? 2, 3, 4. So if I start making those into sales points and start selling sofas from them, I'm going against my fundamental value proposition, which is variety. Because my propositions, I show you 500 sofas. But here, I'm going to now start selling you the 4 sofas that are there in a studio. Why would I, for the short term, which is selling you something from the studio, go against something which is fundamental in the long term, which is variety as a proposition and an underlying principle behind which PepperFry has been set up? So I think this is the choice we made. And I think even as you guys, you know, expand, grow, etc., I think sticking to your core choices actually helps. Because I'll tell you how this would have worked out the other way. Suppose we started selling only those 4 sofas, or 5 sofas, or 10 sofas, and the entire piece, the entire furniture thing, at least in sofas, became about 10 products. Then domain name needs to be available. And pepperfry.com was available. Sure. If you guys are fine, I'm willing to take, unless you want to cap it and I'm getting too onerous for people. Yeah, sorry, there was a question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, hi.
I had a question that as you are talking of consumer behavior, what I noticed as well over the year was that people buy furniture online. That could be a single thing that they find missing, like a table or a chair or a sofa. But I have not seen that people buying all furniture of a 4 BHK house from online. So what you are looking to target that? That comes with a package like interior designer, the carpenter, while building a home.
Totally agree. So it's not that they're not. Actually, a lot of people now buy all of their furniture for their house from something like PepperFry.com. They even buy, so one of our newest categories is called kitchens. And they buy full kitchens on PepperFry.com, and they get installed perfectly into, they get measured, installed into their houses. So people are even have begun buying kitchens from, you know, online. However, I do think it's important for us to, and I'll go back to my slide of the community, for us to engage with the community to ensure that we make inroads into high-value full house purchases, and which is where architects and designers come and play a very important role. So, you know, one of the things, one of our visions for our PepperFry studios, and you, I've talked about the PepperFry studio in answer to a question also, is that they should be like the Starbucks for architects and designers. So it's almost like every studio has its own catchment area of architects and designers, and architects and designers can come, they can use the Wi-Fi for free, they can have coffee, they can meet clients on the PepperFry studio if they want to show a client, you know, hey, there's this is what provincial, or this is what teak wood looks like, or this is what mango wood looks like. All of those products are there in the PepperFry studios. They have ready examples to show them. So we want that kind of engagement to happen with architects and designers. The great news is that's already started happening. We now have 22 studios. As of last count, we have more than 600 architects and designers who are channel partners of the PepperFry. And as they work with their clients, whenever they have you know, suitable projects, those projects, pieces get bought, a lot of those pieces get bought from PepperFry.com. Not well-run businesses, the return rates. So if you don't handle your returns, you'll never be profitable. So it's this balance that you got to strike on an ongoing basis, which is what makes, I guess, a good business successful. Yeah?
So yeah, we'd like to thank Mr. Ambareesh for coming here to IIM Ahmedabad and enlightening us with his entrepreneurial journey. So I'd like to invite Tapish to give a token of appreciation.